Assalamu alaikum. In this video today we will discuss the hearing mechanism, how the sound waves they are conductive to the tympanic membrane and through the ossicles of the middle ear cavity they reach to the internal ear and then perceived by the brain. How this process take place? As we all know, the ear's transduction process, according to which the ear acts as a transducer, and the transduction process can be summarized as follows. Sound waves generated by a vibrating system reach via the ear to the pinna, which is the external part of the ear, which transfers the wave energy through the ear canal towards the tympanic membrane or eardrum, setting it into motion. You can see how these waves, they are reaching the tympanic membrane, and through the tympanic membrane, they are conducted via the three ossicles of the middle ear cavity to the internal ear. I have already told you, in the cochlea, we have three compartments: scala vestibuli, scala media, and scala tympani, and they are separated by a very thin delite membranes. The membrane between the scala vestibuli and the scala media is so thin that we can ignore it. While the membrane between the scala media and the scala tympani, that is the basilar membrane, have the basic receptors for hearing. If we consider the structure of that one, the much more detail I will tell you later on, but in this diagram you can see the reed like structures which are present on the basilar membrane. These are very thick and short in its earlier part as compared to the end. At the end, the scala media and the scala tympani, they are continuous with each other, and this point is called the helicotrema. These reeds like structure, they sets into vibration and the sound is perceived. Whenever the sound waves strike the external ear, reaching to, again I am saying that, reaching to the tympanic membrane, middle ear cavity, and to the oval window, this sets vibration into the fluid present in these compartments so that the round window, it is pushed outward. On the basilar membrane, we have very specific place for different frequencies of the sound waves. High frequency sound waves, they are perceived at the earlier point. Here you can see at this point. Then we have the middle frequency and low frequency sound, they are perceived here near to the apex or near to the helicotrema. Through this animation, you can see how the sound waves, they are perceived, and also check the movement of the round window. This is the transverse view and cross-sectional view also. You can see this movement here also at the same time. Traveling waves are the specific pattern of the sound waves, how they are travel through the cochlear part of our ear. They travel like a wave along the basilar membrane for high, medium and low frequency sound, and as they are traveling like a wave, so these are the traveling these are called as traveling waves. And I have told you that high frequency sound waves, they are perceived here, while the low, they are closer to the heligotrima, they are perceived far away here at the tip. Through this animation you can also see how the low frequency sound waves, they are perceived closer to the apex. One more animation, and I think after watching so many animations you can remember the process of how the sound waves, they are perceived. This is a graph to show the high frequency sound waves, they are perceived here, then middle and low frequency sound waves. This is the pattern of the waves, how they travel, transverse waves or longitudinal waves. Some students not understand what is the definition of the pitch. So I am telling you here, the pitch is all about the wavelength, that is how far apart the pressure waves are. And this animation is just to show you the relationship between the wavelength and the velocity. Now comes the main receptive organ, that is the organ of Corti. What is the function of the organ of Corti? Receptive organ that generates nerve impulses in response to vibration of the basilar membrane. And actually the receptors, which are the hair cells, they are present on the organ of Corti. It's better that I should show this diagram for the better understanding. You can see these are the hair cells, which are the basic receptive cells. They are present in two lines, external and internal, or outer and inner hair cell lines or group, you can say. They are arranged in such a way that they are lying on the basilar membrane, but the tips, they are embedded in a very specific gelatinous substance, that is the tectorial membrane. They are supported by the in next diagram I will show you the how the rods of Corti they are arranged. So in next I will tell you, but here you can see the hair cells, the tips, they are embedded in the tectorial membrane while they are lying over the basilar membrane. This is the animation to show how they act before, but this simple diagram you can understand that sound waves, whenever they come to touch this hair receptor, to reach the hair receptor, they are present in such a way that the movement of the tectorial membrane that take place because of the sound waves, they are pulled apart, put upward, and they are supported by the rods of Corti, so that their upward movement they are that is going to generate the action potential. How it take place, I again tell you, but before that you must see this one. This is the arrangement of the hair cell with the rhodial cortex and the tectorial membrane. They act as a single structure, so that their movement due to the incoming sound waves that creates the action potential. When these hair cells, they are pulled up onto the upper side, different fine cilia, they are attached to the upper end of the hair cells. They are lifted away and they allow the excessive potassium ions to come inside. The permeability that changes, how and from where these potassium ions they are coming in the scalar media, that is another again separate question. I will answer later on, but here you must see that because of the incoming potassium ion, the permeability changes and the action potential is generated, which is conveyed as we have a number of fibers in between the hair cells. So the action potential which is generated here, it is conveyed to the hair center through these nerve fibers, through the cochlear part of the vestibulocochlear nerve. This again showing how the action potential is produced. You can see the change is this one, especially the permeability changes and the action potential that is conveyed to the nervous system. This is the best animation to show the change in the value of the action potential, how it is generated. You can see the mechanism is just the same as you have studied the receptors in the semicircular canals, macula and sacula, in which we have studied when we were studying the cerebellum and the balance of the body. We have discussed the hair cells present in these specific semicircular canals. So the basic mechanism is just the same as in the semicircular canals, that at the upper end of the hair cell we have the stereocilia, in which the last one is the longer one and other they are shorter in length. The movement of the cilia towards the kinocilium or the longest cilia that take place, so that the lid is open to have incoming the potassium ion. As the basilar membrane, this structure is present in the scalar media, in which we have the endolymph, while in the scalar tympani and the scalar vestibuli we have the perilymph. The composition of the perilymph is very much similar to the CSF because they are continuous with that one. But in the scalar media we have the endolymph, and this point is very very important for the depolarization, hyperpolarization, how the action potential is generated at this point. This point is very much necessary because of the excessive potassium ion present in the fluid of the scalar media. From where that is coming? It is the endolymph. From where we are getting the excessive potassium ions? Because of the high blood supply to the scala media, from where these are coming. And the specific structure of the blood, that is the stria vascularis, that is going to secrete the these excessive potassium ions. So the composition of the endolymph present in the scala media, that is opposite to the perilymph. So when this permeability changes, potassium ion come inside, so that the depolarization and hypolarization take place, the impulse is generated and then conveyed to the eye center. Here at this point we have a very specific potential, that polarity is excessive positivity inside the scala media and the excessive negativity outside. Electric potential of about plus 80, you can see from this animation also, exists all the time between the endolymph and the perilymph, with the positivity inside the scala media and negativity in outside. And this specific potential is called the endocochlear potential and is generated by continual secretion of the positive potassium ion into the scala media by the stria vascularis. So in this way the impulse is generated, and you can see from this animation that is conveyed to the higher center, and this is showing the change in the polarity, and here also. Specifically showing the movement of the ear cilia, and due to that positive ions come inside and the impulse is generated. This is another very nice animation. I show you so much animation just to understand the process very well, and also to it's easy to remember the process. When you visualize any process, you can have better understanding and you can remember it in a better way. You can see the opening of the channel, potassium ions, they are going inside due to the movement of these hair cells, and because of that the opening of the channel take place. As I have told you that for the specific frequency of the sound wave, we have specific place for the basilar membrane. Okay, the high frequency sound, they are perceived in earlier part, while the low at the tip closer to the helicotrema. So this specificity about the place, that is called the place principle, that is maintained in the cortical area also. I will show you the next diagram also. So this is the specific pattern how we can differentiate between the different frequencies of the sound coming from the same source. You can differentiate that this is the high frequency and this is the low frequency sound. No doubt they are coming from the same source, but they are perceived at very specific point, separate point on the basilar membrane as well as in the brain also. I will tell you now from the cochlear part, the impulses, they are going to join the cochlear nuclei. From the cochlear nuclei, they are going to the upper part of the medulla. At this point, all the fibers, synapse, and second order neurons pass mainly to the opposite side of the brainstem to terminate in the superior olivary nucleus. Few second order fibers also pass to the superior olivary nucleus on the same side as well. From the superior olivary nucleus, auditory pathway passes upward through the lateral lemniscus. Some of the fibers terminate here, but many bypass this nucleus and travel on to the inferior colliculus, where all or almost all the auditory fibers synapse. From there, the pathway passes to the medial geniculate nucleus, where all the fibers do synapse. And finally, the pathway proceeds by the way to the auditory radiations to the auditory cortex. So in this way, they are perceived in the auditory cortex, which is located mainly in the temporal lobe. From this diagram, you can see that we can have the primary and secondary auditory cortex, and you can also appreciate this point that low frequency and high frequency sound waves, they are separately perceived here also. So they have specific place and separate place in the cortical area also to differentiate between the high and low frequency sound waves. Now the to determine the direction of the sound from where they are coming, the best way is that if we can have mainly 3 points: the time lag between the entry of the sound into one ear and its entry into the opposite ear; the sound waves coming from the one source, they are reaching to your ear but at different speed, but the direction is the different for different sound waves, so that you can locate the sound source. Either it is in front of the ears or behind the ear, from right side or from left side. If a sound is coming from the right side source, the right ear will listen it earlier as compared to the left ear. So in this way, you can locate the direction of the sound waves coming from any source, and also the difference between the intensities of the sound in the two ear. The shape of the pinna changes the quality of the sound entering the ear. Obviously, the sound waves coming from the front, they are reaching to the your pinna earlier as compared to the sound waves which are striking the external ear from behind. So all these things, they can be helpful to locate from where the sound wave they are coming. So in this way, you can have the direction or location, exact location of the sound waves source. This is the summary for the hearing mechanism. I just summarize it again. From the external ear, all the sound waves strike the tympanic membrane. The middle ear cavity, ossicles, they sets in vibration. That's move, and they act as a lever, and it is conveyed to the inner ear, the cochlear part. In the cochlear part, we have 3 compartments: scala vestibuli, media, and tympani, and separated by very fine membranes. But the basilar membrane, which is lying between the scala, media, and the tympani, it has the receptors, hair cells, main receptors for the hearing mechanism. When sound waves reaches here, fluid present in the scalar media, which is different from the composition, which has different composition from the beryllium present in other compartments. It has secreted by the stria vascularis and have excessive potassium ions. Here, the hair receptors, they are present. They, because of the incoming sound waves, they moved in such a way that the potassium channels, they are open, allow excessive potassium ion to come in, and so that the endolymph potential that is going to change, it is going to generate the action potential. Nerve impulse is generated as the nerve fiber, they are lying in between the receptors, these hair cells. So it is conveyed to the cochlear part of the vestibulocochlear nerve. From there, they are reaching to the cochlear nuclei and finally going to the auditory cortex, which is located, which is present in the temporal lobe of the cortex. So this is our story about the how you are going to perceive the sound waves. Now two extra points about this mechanism. You must remember that we have specific place for the specific frequency of the sound waves, that is called the place principle. High, medium and low frequencies, they are separately at different places they are perceived. And also in the cortex we have different place for the low and the high frequency sound waves. The second point is that from where you are receiving the sound wave, what is the source, where it is located. So to locate the source, you must appreciate that the difference in the pitch of the sound, and either it is present in front or behind the pinna, because the in front sound waves, they will reach soon as compared to the behind, which because of the obstruction of the pinna, they are entering in the auditory canal later as compared to the sound waves which are coming from in source present in front of the pinna. So in this way you can hear the sound wave, you perceive the sound waves in the cortical cortex, and also you are able to locate the source of the sound waves. So this is all about the hearing mechanism. In the next video we will inshallah discuss the abnormalities regarding the hearing mechanism, that is deafness, what are the types of the deafness, how we can manage it. So in this in next video we will discuss the abnormalities. Thank you and Allah Hafiz.